Good evening. How many people in the last week have spent more than 5 hours in the company of ESPN? Online, television, radio? More than 10 hours? Okay, I'll stop there. But obviously, you know why you're here. Our speaker tonight, George Bodenheimer, is a cable industry pioneer who served as executive chairman of ESPN from 2012 through 2014, where he provided strategic direction for ESPN's global business. Prior to becoming executive chairman, he served as the company's longest-tenured president from 1998 to 2012, where he led an unprecedented period of global growth. He also oversaw all overseas multimedia sports aspects of the Walt Disney Company from 2003 to 2011, and was co-chairman of Disney Media Networks from 2004 to 2011, a man of many hats. Since 1998, when Mr. Bodenheimer took over as president, through the time of his appointment as executive chairman, ESPN grew to 8 domestic television networks, up from 4 when he took over, 12 HD services, up from 0, 48 international television networks, up from 20, 13 international sports center editions, starting from 0, 18 websites, starting with 1, 750 radio affiliates nationwide from 620, and 7,000 employees, up from 1,900 when he took over. Mr. Bodenheimer's path to leadership mirrors that of ESPN itself, with a sharp focus on creativity and cutting-edge innovations that enhanced values for sports fans and ESPN's business partners, and a commitment to teamwork. He believes ESPN's culture is the company's strategic advantage. His business initiatives were designed with one goal in mind, to bring greater value to all of ESPN's constituent affiliates, advertisers, rights holders, and ultimately, consumers, you and I. His vision created a vibrant, innovative workplace. As president, he viewed his primary role as working hard to preserve and enhance the culture while emphasizing career development for all of ESPN's people. His leadership style is simple but effective. Empower all employees to proactively take charge of their careers and to base decisions on the company's stated mission, namely, serve sports fans anytime, anywhere, anywhere. This room is filled with sports fans, I imagine. And I think in the next hour, Mr. Bodenheimer will serve sports fans. Anytime, the time is now, anywhere, the place is Gasson 100. Mr. George Bodenheimer.
Thank you, Mike. It's a real pleasure to be here. Boston College tonight, beautiful day today, beautiful hall. Really appreciate being invited to be part of the Chamber's lecture series. I also really appreciate you all using a 15-year-old picture of me on that poster out there. I feel good about that. In my time with you tonight, I want to tell you about a little startup company. It started in a bucolic town in Bristol, Connecticut, and how we came into existence, persevered, ultimately prospered, and earned a place in the culture of the United States, I guess as evidenced by the amount of time you all spending with ESPN based on that informal survey a few moments ago, but really earned a place in America culture by forging a market for 24-hour sports, which, believe it or not, to most of you, did not exist a mere 35 years ago. As Mike said, I started in ESPN in the mailroom, so I like to keep things simple. And I believe there's three things that drove the ESPN company all these years: mission, brand, and culture. And I'm going to talk about those three things tonight. We'll take them in order. To go back and understand ESPN, you have to go way back to 1978. Our founder, Bill Rasmussen, worked for the New England Whalers of the World Hockey Association. This was even before they were the Hartford Whalers and before they were in the NHL. And one day, unexpectedly, Bill got fired. He was the head of communications. Now, Bill didn't have a lot of money, but he had passion. And he was running around the Hartford, Connecticut area trying to think of what kind of a business he could start. Back then, cable was just getting started. And he thought about televising University of Connecticut games around the state of Connecticut. That was his original vision. Now, Bill was an entrepreneur, and he was an optimist, which is, of course, another lesson for all of you entrepreneurs and folks who want to go into business after you graduate here. Optimism is a key trait, and Bill was certainly an optimist. So he went to learn about how he might distribute his University of Connecticut games across the state of Connecticut. Even though our state's small, it wouldn't work just on an antenna. And when he went to the RCA company to learn about sending a satellite signal down to earth stations and the cable systems, they said, well, if you buy one of these, they were $35,000 a month to lease one, you don't have to limit your aspirations to the state of Connecticut. The signal that you have, that you will beam down, will go across the entire continental United States. And it was at that moment that ESPN went from a Connecticut network this big, or at least in Bill's mind, to a nationwide network. Next, he needed product. He couldn't just sell University of Connecticut games outside the state. There would have been significant interest. So he went to the NCAA and convinced them to do a contract with him, and he bought 1,400 games a year, everything but live college football. Everything the NCAA had to offer except for live college football, which was all tied up by the broadcast networks at that point. That was his second big deal. So he did the satellite, then he got the product, then he had to find what his revenue model was going to be, and he started calling on advertisers, and he got Anheuser-Busch, knowing that sports fans like to drink a beer now and again. He went to Anheuser-Busch to be his first sponsor and signed them up. So he had those three deals in his pocket. Now, not many people in the whole United States were around that first night, September 7th, 1979, and certainly most of the people in this room here tonight weren't there. So I brought along the first couple of minutes of ESPN's existence on the air, September 7th, 1979. Take a look.
If you're a fan, what you'll see in the next minutes, hours, and days to follow may convince you you've gone to sports heaven. Beyond that blue horizon is a limitless world of sports, and right now you're standing on the edge of tomorrow. Sports, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, with ESPN, the Total Sports Cable Network. Yea, verily, a sampler of wonders. Hi, I'm Lee Leonard, welcoming you to Bristol, Connecticut, 110 miles from New York City. Why Bristol? Because here in Bristol is where all the sports action is as of right now. And we're just minutes away from the first event on the ESPN schedule. That's the 1979 NCAA College Football Preview. And then we're going to follow that with a doubleheader of games. Two of the Professional Slow Pitch League World Series games will be seen tonight. Now, softball is one of those rare sports that everybody knows something about. Why? Because we all play it on Sunday when we drink a little beer. Now, here's another innovation. on ESPN, and it's going to be a big part of our future. The Sports Center with George Grand. He'll have the latest on what's happening all around. George?
Thanks, Lee, and welcome everyone to the ESPN Sports Center. From this very desk, in the coming weeks and months, we'll be filling you in on the pulse of sporting activity, not only around the country, but around the world as well. If it takes an interview, we'll do it. If it takes play-by-play, we'll do it. If it takes commentary, we'll do that too. That's the way we'll function from the ESPN Sports Center, and we'll be filling you in on further updates as the broadcast progresses.
So as you can see, it was a relatively modest beginning. What with those Soviet-era-style graphics and the not-so-subtle plug for our first big advertiser, Anheuser-Busch. But despite the modest beginning and all the jokes, George Grand uttered something at the first SportsCenter desk that night that I think really is crucial and drove the company. He said, "We're going to be here every night to serve sports fans." And that was, of course, what became the mission of the company, to serve fans. Now, we started doing that quickly, but I really believe that that's what got us off the right foot. You know, from the very first night, we're going to be here every night trying to do our best to produce SportsCenter and serve the fans in a manner that is going to do a good job in getting them the sports news of the day. Now, we started doing that right off the bat, mostly with things no one else cared to televise. How about producing tape delay college football off the back of a pickup truck? Or how about this Boston College hockey game? Come on, let's hear it for Boston College here. Now, even long before I was president, it looks like I could have gotten you tickets to this game. Or how about a little slow pitch softball? As Lee said that first night, the first ever trivia question, the first ever event to air live on ESPN was two games from the slow pitch softball World Series. The Kentucky Bourbons versus the Milwaukee Schlitzes, sponsored by Budweiser. I mean, we had it all going that very first night. Or how about a little Australian rules football? You don't have NFL football. You don't have live college football from the United States. Let's import football from Australia. We ran the sprockets off of this back in the old days, and we still televise it. It was crazy. It looked crazy, though, right? I mean, it was a very rough version of football. The guys wear no equipment, and the referees look like pharmacists from CVS. We put up a graphic on the screen. It basically said, "We don't know the rules either. If you would like the rules, send us a postcard." We got over 15,000 postcards. I know. I was in the mailroom. And I had to lug them along with my colleagues over to the marketing department so we can ship you a copy of Australian Rules Football, the rules of the game. But, you know, tonight, ESPN televises, we got a film tonight on, a 30 for 30 film. We'll know by the time the guys get into breakfast tomorrow, we'll know how many people were watching that. 35 years ago, we had no tangible way to know if people were even watching. So when we got 15,000 postcards to say, "We would like to, you know, please send me a rule book on Australian rules football," it was one of the first tangible signs that ESPN had that there were fans out there actually starting to enjoy what we were doing. It was one of the first things we had to say, "My gosh, you know, there's fans out there, and they're watching." So the most important thing, whether you're running a company, you're running Boston College, or you're doing anything, is to define your mission. In our case, it was to serve sports fans, and to drive it home every chance you get. In my 13 years as president of ESPN, I never, ever, ever missed an opportunity to talk about how important it was to continue to serve sports fans. I was asked a million questions as president of ESPN. What are you going to do next to service the next iPhone? Are you going to serve Android? What's the next mobile product? Are you going to be in Singapore? What are you doing in Latin America? I give them my favorite answer. I don't know. But what I do know is I got 8,000 employees who know what the mission of the company is and to serve fans. So when the next iPhone comes out, nobody's waiting for a memo from the corner office. Gee, I wonder if George thinks it's a good idea to serve the iPhone. No. I want our employees to know what the mission of the company is and know that there's no doubt that ESPN is going to serve that phone. And we want to be there first with the best possible product we could be. And that's all about, you know, that's all about communicating a mission. Again, whether you're running a company or you're running this college or any other organization, defining your mission and driving it home is important. And to me, in the business environment, the most important group is your employees. Yes, your customers are important, your suppliers are important, of course, but your employees, to know what your mission is one of the most important things you can do as a leader, in my opinion. Next, I'd like to talk about brand. Brand is often a confusing topic, particularly if you're not a marketer, which I was not and am not a marketer. And it often can be a confusing subject, but it doesn't have to be. It's a pretty simple concept. A brand is what comes to mind when you mention a product, a company, or even a person. It's what comes to mind when you think about that product, person, or company. That's the brand. And it's extremely important that you build and bolster your brand. Now, we were a young company, and we had a lot of rough moments in the early going, like I'm sure a lot of other companies out there.
Well, we're here. Hello. That's the situation in the NL West when Sunday's play began. The Dodgers and Giants deadlocked. I'm heading south.
Scores!
We've had a power problem here in beautiful downtown Bristol, Connecticut. But you are still hearing us through the magic of satellite.
Fans booed and take those two performances and even pounded on the truck he was in when he left the park last night. Can we give you the mic?
Thanks.
Yes, this is television where you need a microphone, that is for sure. Okay, so there you see Dave Revson walking right behind me.
Andy, what's your take on this? You agree with Jeff?
Clearly, this is a veteran team, and they take a great deal of satisfaction in this.
Well, they do take a lot of satisfaction.
The same team that had a 49% interest sold also had a major trade rescinded.
All right, so that's the latest word from Jack Donlin. What about the word from NFL Commissioner Pete Rozelle?
He dumped a paper bag containing stocks and bonds worth $1 million. The set is jumping. We'll see you next week.
Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem.
Oh, say, can you see? And the Rockets, red flag.
Uh-oh. written by Francis Scott Off-Key.
But I think the one thing that's interesting about the USFL people, George, is...
George. In Mobile, Alabama, for SportsCenter, Lou Palmer, ESPN.
Runners on your mark. Yes, sir.
Together, Ramos.
The key to success in the offensive huddle is concentration, and it's over a very short.
Together, Ramos and Hedak sparked the U.S. offense in the second half against Germany.
Now for Keith Millard, he's almost home again as training camp nears an end.
Can I have you for dinner?
As Syracuse comes from behind of the end to beat Georgetown.
That's a wrap.
Oh my gosh, I've only seen that 1,000 times, and I laugh every time I see it. But you know, all companies have their tough times, and certainly all television networks have blooper reels like that. But for us, I think it was something different. It taught us to have fun. It taught us to laugh at ourselves. It taught us to take our sports seriously, but don't take ourselves too seriously. And that's a really important part of the ESPN brand. I mean, remember, or perhaps not remember for most of you, but 35 years ago, sports was delivered in a very straightforward manner, a couple of minutes after the local weather, assuming there was no bad weather and sports was cut short, but it was delivered in a very straightforward manner. People hadn't seen this before with anchors breaking up, losing microphones, having fun, giving each other a hard time, making up nicknames. This just hadn't been seen before. But we know from our research that it's a big part of what people like yourselves like about ESPN, having fun and seeing the personality of the anchors come out. And so, you know, it became a part of the ESPN brand. And that's really, you know, the point here is you got to build and nurture your brand, particularly now that as this world goes digital. I don't care what business you're in, but your competitor is only a mouse click away. So, you know, you better have a strong brand that people identify with, and you better continue to find ways to bolster that brand and build it and know what's likable about it and bolster that all the time. We were fortunate a few years after that blooper tape was, you know, from the years it was an advertising campaign was developed by our advertising agency, which is Wieden and Kennedy, out of Portland, Oregon. And you remember the first night when Lee Leonard declared that as of right now, Bristol, Connecticut is the center of the sports world? You know, it was a bit presumptuous, but that was his line. Well, the idea behind this campaign was, well, gee, if ESPN is the center of the sports world, won't some of the world's greatest athletes be coming to Bristol and coming to our offices? And that was the genesis behind the This Is Sports Center campaign, which is now 400 spots later. It's been running 20 years, which is an eternity for an advertising campaign. I brought along a few of my favorites. Two of them are relatively current. The last one is from way back in the year 2000, when you might recall everyone's computers were going to stop working and the ATMs weren't going to work and the whole world was going to fall apart at the stroke of midnight when it turned to 2000. Take a look.
Hey, Ovi.
Hey, what's up?
What are you doing in the dark, man?
Nothing, just the late night filings.
Really? Late night filing? What are you, a Russian spy or something?
Yeah, right.
All right, I'll catch you later.
Hey, see ya.
Принесло.
Да, чуть не спалили.
It's hard to find an expert more dedicated than John Clayton. He's the consummate pro.
We'll see how the 4-3 and the cover 3 work together.
John Clayton, with the latest.
Thanks, Dan. Take care.
And whenever we need a brilliant insight, he's available at the drop of a hat.
The year 2000 approaching, we're trying to make sure the software here at SportsCenter is Y2K compliant.
Y2K test in 3, 2, 1.
Oops. More from the NBA and an NFL trade right after this.
We definitely have a few bugs to work out, but we'll be ready.
Now, I know we're in Boston. I know we got a lot of Boston fans. Probably a few New York fans as well, am I right? Just a couple? All right, we got a few. Anyway, I dug through the archives to find this. This is SportsCenter spot.
Jorge.
Yeah?
What's going on with your hat?
It's from my hat, man.
I mean, it doesn't look like a ball player's hat. I mean, it looks all brand new.
Just come out of the box.
I'm a catcher, man. I never had to wear that thing.
You got a big stand. Hey, Wally. Wally.
know what you think.
Well, when we first started that campaign, we thought we were going to have trouble getting the world's best athletes to come to Bristol. We don't pay them for it. We make a small donation to their favorite charity. But for 20 years now, that campaign has been going. We've had no difficulty getting athletes to Bristol to shoot those spots. But I've had the pleasure, I just left ESPN in May after 33 years, and I had the pleasure really traveling all over the world for the company, and I can't tell you how many times people wanted to talk to me about these commercials all around the world. They want to talk about these commercials, and it's done so much to help. I don't think there's a more tangible asset out there that communicates the ESPN brand. Having fun, not taking yourselves too seriously. Really, they've done a big job for us. And we wanted to make sure our employees, goes back to treating your employees with respect and making sure they know your mission. We wanted to make sure that they knew how we were thinking about our brand. Again, it can be a complicating and intimidating subject for a lot of people. And again, in my view, it doesn't need to be at all. So we developed what we called the ESPN brand promise so we could talk to our employees about it. So we developed the promise, ESPN is sports, which is what we do. With authority, how we do it, we try to get every score right, every name pronunciation, you know, everything we report right. We don't always get it right, but that is our goal. And of course, what we've been talking about here, the personality is what I think sets us apart. Our on-air talent, having fun, the commercials, the way we go about business. That's how we think about the ESPN brand. And then there's the ESPN brand promise. And we talk about it with our employees all the time so they understand how we're thinking about the company and the brand in particular. Lastly, and what I think is the most important thing, is culture. Why do I think it's the most important thing? There are plenty of things out there that a business cannot control. Obviously, you can't control the economy. We can't control when we have bad games or a blowout and people just, you know, want to tune to a different game. We're not going to win every contract despite our success. You're going to have problems. There's a lot of things in business that you cannot control. But one that you can control is your culture. And it's why I believe it's the most important thing. It's why I call it ESPN strategic advantage. I don't know what it was. Again, we're only a couple hours from here in Bristol, Connecticut. Maybe it was our bucolic setting. We're not near major cities. Maybe it was our hardworking kind of New England lunch pail work ethic, kind of blue collar work ethic. Maybe it was the fact that we were the laughing stock of the television business for many years before we got really any success and people thought 24-hour sports was a nutty thing. So I don't know what it was, but out of some combination of all that, a culture was developed in Bristol, Connecticut, built on optimism, focus, hard work, passion, respect for others. And those are the things that drive the ESPN company today. And I'd like to go through some of those and highlight for you how I think about those. The first is The Little Engine That Could. Perhaps you've heard of it. It was a book written in the 1930s. It's only sold 10 million copies worldwide, translated into 40 or 50 languages. Teaches optimism and hard work. Perhaps you familiar with the story. You know, there was a big job of taking this big payload up a steep mountain, and none of the big engines wanted to do it. And the little engine said, I'll sign up for that, and he got it done. And I invoke this all the time at our company. We were the underdog for a lot of years. Then we woke up one day and we were successful. Then we woke up 2 weeks later and we were part of the Walt Disney Company. You know, the Walt Disney Company, ESPN is driving in part the earnings of the Walt Disney Company. But despite that success, I never, ever wanted our company to give up that underdog mentality. Being an underdog is a very powerful concept for a company, an athlete, a student, an executive, what it is. I mean, you just work harder. And I used to give this speech all the time to our employees, and they started to call it the underdog speech. But I love it. And I never want ESPN to think of itself as anything other than an underdog who has to work harder and remember our roots and fight for everything we have, every point of market share, every contract, you know, everything. And I believe in this wholeheartedly. Next is passion. I guarantee you that our competitors in the television business underestimated the passion of the ESPN employees in the early years, and you can see some pictures of our employees from the early years here. Our people worked harder, they outworked our competitors. It was employee passion, it was ESPN employee passion that developed things like a yellow line to mark where a first down is on a football field. My gosh, does anybody ever want to watch a football game again and not know exactly where the first down line is? Of course not. That was ESPN. It was the passion of the ESPN employees that thought, hey, it might be interesting for college football fans and NFL football fans to watch the NFL draft. When our president, Chet Simmons, went over and proposed that to Pete Rozelle, he thought that it was a crazy idea, but he supported it because we were partners. The draft has now grown into a three-night primetime affair that outrates some games. They're moving it to Chicago next year. I mean, it's a huge event. That was an ESPN innovation as well. Many things are attributable to the passion of employees. And people used to ask me all the time, what do you look for in people you want to hire at ESPN? Well, I look for a few things, but one of them is passion. You know why? Because people with passion over-deliver. Whether you're a student and you're working hard to make sure you get that paper right, whether you're a businessman, making sure in this case a production is going to come out right, whether you're a SportsCenter producer and it's 4 a.m. and you're recutting SportsCenter to get that last score in there or get something that wasn't quite right, and you stay that extra hour at 4:30 a.m. to make sure it's right for the fans that are going to wake up and watch it in the next morning, that's passion. And passion drives a lot of things. It certainly drove the ESPN company to where it is today. We were also lucky to be in the sports business. And of course, we benefited from the passion that people have for sports. One of my first jobs at ESPN after I got out of the mailroom was I took a job down in Texas selling ESPN in Texas, Arkansas, Oklahoma, Louisiana, and Mississippi. I'd never even been to that part of the country before. And I was trying to call on 3 cable operators a day, 3 mom and pops. And I'd go in and I'd say, hey, I'm from Connecticut. I should have dropped that whole Connecticut thing because it wasn't that popular down there. But we have this 24-hour sports network, and you have a 12-channel cable system with plenty of open space. We'd like you to put ESPN on your cable system. I heard the same answer every town I went to. I don't care whether I was in Texas, Arkansas, Oklahoma, Louisiana, or Mississippi, I heard the same answer. Gee, George, that really sounds like a crazy idea, 24 hours of sports. But if you'll give it to us, which we were at the time, we'll put it on because, you know, this is a sports town. And what I learned, whether you're in Waco, Texas, Biloxi, Mississippi, Boston, Massachusetts, New York, Tulsa, every town in America considers themselves a sports town. It may vary, high school, college, or pro. It varies based on where you are. But every town in this country is a sports town. And ESPN was able to, you know, obviously we could take advantage of the passion that people have for sports, and it helped grow this company greatly. I later learned as ESPN grew out the United States, that it's true in every country in the world. Sports are important to people. Sports matter. They bring people together. They're an oasis for people. My gosh, look at what your pro teams did here after the marathon bombing recently, a couple years ago, I guess now. The horrific event. Look what the teams did. Look what it meant to Boston and the healing in this city for what the teams did to bring people back. Look what happened in New York after 9/11. the place that the part that the teams played in that, and basically helping America heal, and hearing Jack Buck come back on the air in the World Series, you know, with some, you know, great lines about, you know, this is the, we, you know, we needed to be back. Sports play a big role in this country, and obviously ESPN was able to grow with that, but it's passion. This is a picture from 1965, actually only a couple hours west of here, Mount St. Herman's High School. And as you can see, it was a Deerfield Academy at Mount St. Herman's Northfield Academy game. You can see that the players and the people in the stands maintained their focus while the science building was burning down, literally right by the behind the bleachers. I had this picture blown up about 4 feet by 4 feet, and it hung outside my office for about 15 years, just to talk about, as an opportunity to talk about people who are focused on their priorities. About in 2002, I had only been president a few years, we were going through some tough times. Our ratings were absolutely tanking. Every show, every day part, nothing was working. And I was asking people, what do you want to do about this ratings problem? And I got a lot of blank stares, like people didn't even know we had a problem. So I put 60 people in a room and said, guys, we have a big problem here. Our ratings are tanking, and no one seems to be fully aware of it, and therefore no one has any kind of a plan to fix it. What do you think we ought to do? Somebody raised their hand and said, why don't we make it the company's number one priority to raise our ratings? Pretty basic suggestion. From that was born this priority system that's been going, you know, for the last 13 or 14 years, where we develop company priorities and we print them on a card and we give them to each of our employees. It serves a lot of purposes. I know it sounds unbelievably simple, but it shows respect for your 7,000 employees. You know, you've got senior management, call it, you know, couple of hundred people, so you got 700 minus 200, you got 6,800 people who aren't in senior management. I found most of them were thirsting for information about the company. They wanted to know what the priorities of the company were. And the process of going through it, printing it on a card and showing them the respect of giving one to each employee proved tremendously empowering to our people. It showed that we respected them. And it goes back to what I said earlier about that iPhone. Some new technology comes out, or someone has an idea. I do not want them waiting for a memo from the corner office. I wonder what George thinks, if he thinks we ought to, you know, move in that direction. No. You know what the mission is to serve fans. You know what the priorities of the company are in any one year. You're talented in your area, whether you're a producer, an accountant, communications, finance, what have you, whatever area of the company, and you're experts in those areas. You tell us what the company should do. My job as president, I thought of myself as a servant leader. My job was to support the employees because they would tell us how to move forward, serve the fans, and do it within the context of these priorities. I can't tell you how many CEO types came up to me over the years and say, hey, George, you know, I hear that you set company priorities, and I hear that you print them on a card, and I hear that you give one to everybody. Can you tell me about it? I said, well, sure. We set annual priorities, we print them on a card, and we give one to everybody. Guess what? It works. And I can't tell you how, I can tell you without a shred of doubt that simple process over the last, since 2001, has helped drive the ESPN company. And it never got any better for me when I was in Bristol, walking around, whether parking my car in the fitness center, lunch, meeting, whatever, and someone would say to me, hey, George, I just want to tell you, I was in a meeting last week, and we didn't know which way to turn. Like every meeting, you know, there's multiple ways to go, and there's often problems. But we pulled out our card, and we thought about the solutions in the context of the priorities, and we decided to do X. For me, as a manager, as the president of ESPN, it never got any better than that, than to see our employees thinking for themselves, taking into account the mission, take into account the culture, take into account what we were telling them was important for the next year, and moving in that direction and not waiting around. I was trying to build a company of empowered employees that knew what to do themselves, because I believe in the power of that, and I believe in people. I also told you that I never missed an opportunity to pound home our mission, so in this case, we just printed it on the back side of the card, but I always took advantage of that. Now, maybe it was my mailroom background, or working my way up from the bottom, but I love, you know, Vince Lombardi has met more good quotes than just about any sports person out there. And to me, I love this quote, because to me, it talks about everybody in a company, or everyone in Boston College, or everybody on an athletic team. Everybody's important. And the strength of an overall organization is based on the strength of everybody participating, everybody having an opportunity to participate. By the way, here's a current look at the ESPN mailroom, just giving a little shout out to my mailroom guys. But I guarantee you the ESPN company doesn't run without the mailroom, and I guarantee you Boston College doesn't run without the mailroom and all the other people providing, you know, good services to your college here or any company. It takes a team to run a company or a college, and respecting all the employees and the roles that they do, I think is a very important position for a leader to take. Sorry about this New York Yankee thing here, although I guess I noticed we have a few Yankee fans in here. But I like this quote from Casey Stengel as well. It's hilarious. He couldn't have done it without his players. It was after one of his World Series victories. But that's my point. You can't run a company without all of your employees, or a college, or a sports team. It's about everybody. So to me, that's what it is. You develop a culture where people feel empowered, they know what the objectives are, they know their leaders respect them, and you develop a culture that breeds and feeds on success and that expects to succeed. The ESPN company, the people, expect to succeed. They expect to maintain a leadership position in a very competitive business, and they know that their management is there to support them in following the mission and continuing to do that. So we've talked about these three things, mission, brand, and culture, that I believe are key to running the ESPN company. Now, our mission has evolved over the years. I'm sure everybody in this room has a phone and probably a smartphone in their pocket. Of course, they didn't exist when we started out and we were just a TV company. So we updated our mission over the years several times, in fact. This is the most recent. But we want to serve fans anytime, anywhere. Goes back to my iPhone example. When our employees read that a new technology is coming out, they know the mission. They are not waiting around for management or the president to decide if we're going to do something. They know that's the mission of the company, and they're going to move. The brand has grown over the years from Australian rules football World Series softball and taped delay college football. We'll have we've got Monday Night Football, we've got the Masters, we've got the College Football Championship, just came off the World Cup this year. I mean, the growth of the brand has enabled us to grow over the years from those early days. And lastly is the culture. You know, I tell our people all the time, let's continue to make this our strategic advantage. It drives companies, it drives colleges, it drives sports teams, and it's set from the top. You know, you all are fortunate here to go to this fine university, and you'll be entering the university, or you'll be entering the workforce when you graduate here. And I'm sure many of you are going to aspire to be leaders in whatever you do. Well, just remember that whatever entity you're working for, if you're the leader, or you're the leader of a department, it doesn't even have to be a company. The culture starts at the top, period. The top person in any organization sets the culture and must embody it. But if you can set it up where it's your strategic advantage, you got a big opportunity going forward. Business is tough out there. There's a lot of obstacles. But I believe that if you get your mission set, you grow your brand, and you have a good culture, you got a big head start on many of the other businesses out there. One last thing. I believe it's important for companies to give back. And obviously you have a fine college here that is also works hard to support people who are less fortunate than you are. We do a lot of things to support people that are less fortunate than we are. One of them is we raise money for cancer research. Our colleague, pictured here, Jim Valvano, passed away of cancer in 1993, and we formed the V Foundation for Cancer Research. We've raised about $150 million since 1993. We've extended grants to researchers of $130 million over those 20 years. And the only reason I put that up is I think it's important for companies to give back. And I also know there's a lot of people out there that want to contribute in their communities and help other people. And I believe that companies should make it easy for their employees who want to give back. So we support our employees, whether they want to help us raise money for cancer research, or they want to help returning veterans, or they want to help homeless people. I mean, gosh knows there's a lot of people out there that need assistance. And we try to make it easier on our employees and support them in doing that. I think that's a big supporter of our culture, is being willing to give back. So for us, it all begins and ends with sports fans. And I like to close with a little video here that's dedicated to all sports fans, not only in the United States, but around the world.
Raleigh, North Carolina.
Rockland, Wisconsin.
Vallejo, California.
Jekyll Island, Georgia.
Hayesville, Ohio.
Bowling Green, Kentucky.
My favorite sports team is Pittsburgh Steelers.
The Packers.
Packers are like your kids. You don't love them because they're good. You love them because they're yours.
Go Phillies, go Eagles, go Sixers, go Flyers, go Irish.
I like Eric Austin, Tony Hawk, Mucky Lassick.
I support the University of Wyoming Cowboys.
Let's go Cardinals.
Tell you.
New York Yankees, my least favorite baseball team.
Go Vols.
I have a camera crazy.
It's always game day.
I live in every parking lot in the country.
You gotta love your team, and I love this team more than anything in the world.
That's what it's all about.
Some tenderness, walk upon the water, we rise above the mist, with a little peace and some harmony. We'll take the world together, we'll take them by the hand.
3,000, history with an exclamation point.
Thank you very much.